I want. Oh, okay. They're recording us anyway. I wanted to show you this. I found it on the side of the road last week. We've talked about our 10 historical cemeteries that are in the school district. One of them is the Tarleton Young, or usually referred to as the Young Tarleton Family Cemetery. And it is off of 360, just west of Walsh Tarleton Lane, where, and it's at the back entrance of that new condo complex. There has been utility work, and so there have been a lot of brush and trees removed. So now from 360, you can easily see the entrance to the Young Tarleton Cemetery. It took me years to figure out exactly which corner it was on and where it was, but now it's very easy to see. And one of the family members has built this beautiful wrought iron gate that opens the cemetery now. The old gate was kind of thrown to the side during this utility construction, and it had this on it.
Oh my.
But also there was a wrought iron piece that is down in the car. I couldn't carry them both. It's more artistic that the family had done, and it has the date of origin of 1897 on that piece. I found an email address and emailed the family asking if these were going to be tossed away. I was afraid, you know, City of Austin was going to come through and clean up or something. So I asked if I could remove the signs that were on the old gate and possibly use them to anchor a display of our historic cemeteries at the History Center. And within 15 minutes, one of the younger descendants got back to me and said, "That is so exciting. Yes, probably. Let me check with all my aunts and uncles." And she did. She let me know that they have actually applied for and been granted a Texas historical marker for the cemetery. There'll be a ceremony in January. So nice. That might be fun for us to be in.
Can I tell you that out at the HEB and B Caves, at the far end of the parking lot, there's kind of a freestanding Bank of America bank, and then an entrance that goes into the Upland subdivision there. Mm-hmm. And right next to the bank, it's all overcrowded, and you can't really see it stuff. It's out of, is the burial grounds for the Bowles family, which was one of the really early settlers out here. And I'm pretty sure Seven Oaks, the subdivision, has some restored cabins. And I'm pretty sure those are the Bowles cabins.
Yes, Spanish Oaks
right
definitely
down
has
the
Bowles.
From where, so if anybody's out in BK, go to that Bank of America and come get on the backside. I was really surprised to see it.
Yeah. One month, we'll do a really interesting program on all of the historic cemeteries in Western Travis County that Dr. Ruth Hack, is that how you pronounce it, Hack?
Yeah.
Who was an administrator for the school district, particularly in special education for years, did a project back in the 70s and left us a notebook about this thick that has an inventory of every single cemetery. And her purpose for doing that was so that could be used in classrooms to do math problems, to do probabilities, you know, of what people died from, of whether or not boys or girls were born into the family, of who might have settled the area. I mean, she had all of these academic questions that she asked that required an analysis of the historical cemetery data. So it's really a wonderful piece of work that is passed down for us to be able to use now.
Ellen, has there been any move to put those on Find a Grave?
Good question. No.
That would be helpful to people.
Some of them we did put on Find a Grave.
You did?
Jen, okay. Jen did.
Okay.
Sure.
So yes. Okay. Some of them have. That's great.
As a genealogist, yes.
Yes, as a genealogist, very definitely. Okay, well, we've got a lot to cover today. Thank you so much for being here. It's so fun to see all of you and all of your connections. Dan, you may be the first one you may be our only new member today.
Okay.
Tell us your connection to Westlake, the West Bank.
Westlake? Well, let's see here. When did we move out here? Oh, yeah, it was 83 Cotton Bowl game, which didn't work out well. Right before the end of 1982, moved out with the kids, One of them was about five, and the other one wasn't born yet. So I moved out here for the school district. It worked out real well.
Okay, so you'll be aware of some of the more recent history.
Compared to all these other people.
Why don't Dan tell us about his Civil War history?
Well, I actually fought in the Civil War.
Then he became a student.
Yeah, very interesting. So, and all the drama. Okay. Those people went through it was absolutely incredible what they did and the punishment they took.
Well, we'll tap into your knowledge and get you to be up here behind the podium someday.
Okay.
Okay. Well, today we are going to start our celebration of 150 years. Of public education in Eanes. Think about that. 150 years. Does that take you back a little bit? That in the old way of speaking in Texas, they talked about ringing the children in. Mm. And this is the bell that the teachers at the Eanes school used at the turn about 1902, 1905, that part of the era of Eanes. So this is the bell that's been ringing the children in for quite a number of years, not quite 150, but we're really excited that we have our original bell. To start this discussion, I first want to answer a question, kind of. Next slide. Is the Eanes School District the oldest continuously operating school in the state of Texas? That has been a claim of the Eanes History Center since the 1980s. I get asked that a lot. I get challenged on that a lot. So I never know quite how to answer it. I have been able to do some research and found that the Brenham ISD was actually the first that incorporated as an ISD, but we don't claim to be an ISD. We know that that didn't happen for us until the 1950s. So I don't think we're in competition with Brenham. Texas School for the Deaf has a pretty good claim. They actually started in 1856 before the Civil War, which was highly unusual, but they were not considered an educational institution. They were more of a medical or asylum. And so they were not recognized as an educational institution until the 1940s. So we probably can, and they drew from a large area. You know, we were local and concentrated in a community. The claim that always drove me crazy, because the Austin Statesman always put it on the front page, was that Pease Elementary in AISD always claimed to be the oldest continuously operating elementary school. And what they really should have been saying is in the same building, because the Pease building was used for 144 years until it was shuttered in 2020. And how dare they shutter their most historic building? but it didn't start until 1876. So that was 4 years after we got going out here. So those were the ones that I could actually document. Now I have had challenges from people from New Braunfels, from Kerrville, who had city schools, but today it's really hard to find the history on some of those city schools. Many of them were private schools, a German school, a Catholic school, for example. And so I have not been able to disprove that we are the oldest continuously operating school-ish in Texas, especially given that our schools have been in the same general area, and that would be the area that now encompasses Eanes Elementary School. So take what you will from this. Okay, to give you a little bit of background, and all of these things will be important in just a minute, you'll see how they all fit together. The story for the Eanes School District started with a guy called Alexander Eanes. He actually moved from Mississippi with his family and his slaves before the Civil War, 1854, which was pretty early in Austin's history. He built a house on Sabine and 19th Street, but and lived there. But he liked to he was a real estate entrepreneur. So he bought and sold parcels out here in the Western Hills. A lot of people who lived in town also bought a little bit of land out here so that they could cut the wood, and if they had any animals, they had a little bit of rural space. But virtually nobody lived out here. This area was so isolated by the Colorado River and by Barton Creek. And so virtually nobody lived in the hills. Before the Civil War and during the Civil War, it was the outlaws and the in-laws. That Travis County was one of only a handful of counties in Texas that did not vote to secede. This was a Union stronghold, a Union sympathizer stronghold. And but when the Texas voted to go with the Confederacy, a lot of Unionists either left the area or they hid in the hills. They probably didn't know that there were Confederate soldiers also in the hills, because we understand that where Barton Creek Mall is where there was a Confederate manufacturing organization for gunpowder using the guano from the bats that were in the caves along Barton Creek. After the war, Alexander Eanes became sexton of the city cemeteries, basically Oakwood Cemetery. And at that point in time, the sexton of the city cemetery was a pretty big job, because it wasn't, yes, it was the death records and the cemetery records, but virtually all vital records were kept by the sexton. So he was kind of the boss of everybody, in a way of speaking. After the war, during Reconstruction, another very important thing happened. A new constitution was passed for the state of Texas. And in that constitution, surprising as it was, given that it was a Reconstruction one, a lot of the organization for education in Texas for the next 100 years was established. The State Board of Education was established. The Permanent School Fund was set up that still funds today. Each county was, a county supervisor was appointed in each county. And it was mandated that students from the age of 6 to the age of 18 go to school for about 4 months of the year. They were very respectful of the harvest seasons and the planting seasons. So my guess is it was probably November, December, January, and February were the months of school. So that applied to Travis County, this new state constitution did. And Travis County was designated as State District 27. And a guy by the name of Judge Sebron Sneed was made the county supervisor. Well, enter the stage Robert Eanes. He's the important guy. That Robert lived in, was born in South Carolina, but he grew up in Mississippi and had his adult life mainly in Mississippi. Much to my chagrin, when I actually found the census document, he is listed as a liquor distributor in 1850. I debated whether or not, as a school board member, I bring that to your attention. But I understand that he and his wife had an inn and a tavern. By 1860, he was described as a miller, and I believe this to be a miller of grain as opposed to a sawmiller. So, you know, he kept trying different things, as many people did during that era, trying to figure out what he could make work. But apparently after the Civil War, there wasn't much of anything that he could make work, because when he was my age, when he was 67 years old, he packed up 8 children and his wife, loaded things onto prairie schooners, probably about 3, and came west. We think it took about 6 weeks, between 5 and 6 weeks, traveling maybe 20 miles a day if your wheel didn't break, or if you didn't get to the Mississippi River and it was flooded or something like that. So they come to where his brother is. I was telling this story to someone the other day, and they said, had they seen Alexander since 1850s? I don't know. I am not that old. I was not living when Robert Eanes was. But Robert had communicated with his brother Alexander, and he came out here and he bought some of that land that Alexander kind of fooled around with, trading, bartering with so much. And he settled in some sort of structure, maybe even their wagons to begin with, that was about where Highway 360 and Lost Creek Boulevard intersect. I found references that back in the 80s, that's where people thought that original cabin of Robert Eanes might have been. But the important thing was, he'd been here 15 minutes, and this Judge Sneed asked him to be the school trustee for this part of the county. Why in the world, this guy from Mississippi, who hadn't really settled on a career, wasn't like he was a senior statesman or an educator, he gets asked. Well, I don't know, but I have a couple of hypotheses. One is he had a passel of children. Another is he actually lived out here, and there were very few European families out here at the time. And the third thing was that job his brother had as the sexton of the city, he was probably in like Flint with folks like Judge Sneed. And Judge Sneed was asking around, saying, anybody know who could be the trustee for that area, that godforsaken area that nobody can get to? And Robert Eanes was asked to be the school trustee. Well, I can't emphasize this enough. Robert Eanes said yes. I don't know why he said yes, but he said yes. And thank goodness. Before the year was out, so think about this timeline. They leave Mississippi after the spring rains. They get to this area in about June. He gets asked to be a trustee, and then he had to build a school. He had help from one neighbor. They built a log cabin. And then school starts by the end of that year, by the end of 1872, in a one-room log cabin that probably looks the same style of this one that is in Zilker Park. This is not, the actual cabin is long, long gone. This is not the actual one, but we think it was very similar to this. One thing that I've come to realize is that it wasn't necessarily that, you know, there was a big community that so, oh, Robert Eanes, thank you for doing that for us. You're this icon of the community. Nobody knew him. There wasn't many other people out here. So it wasn't like they were honoring him by naming the Eanes School after him. It was just, that was the name that was associated with the school. And it was actually the school whose name we carried on through the years. It was called the Eanes School because that's how the area got identified. And I've actually seen obituaries as late as 1938 that talk about someone being born in the Eanes School area. So it was really the school and not Robert himself who was honored.
Ellen, I have a question. Uh-huh. Do you happen to know if there was any money attached to this trustee position? Was he going to get paid for being?
I don't think so. Trustees are not paid now in Texas. They are in some states, but I don't know that there's ever been a tradition of that.
But that to me would be a motivator.
That would be.
Children.
That would be a motivator.
The other is, he's the new guy. Sometimes you give the new guy the hardest job and say, well, they're new, they don't know any better.
good suggestion there.
When you say Smith Creek, are you talking about Eanes Creek?
I am a stubborn historian here that the creek that runs behind Eanes Elementary School and then goes across Camp Craft Road, and in fact it comes kind of through the neighborhood next to us here, goes down by eventually it gets back to BK Road at the Finish Line Car Wash and goes in. Historically, that was called Eanes Creek. It's called Smith Creek.
There had to be a spring or something for them to locate there. They had to have water.
that the spring, actually, when Robert Eanes' daughter and her husband owned the ranch, they moved the house to Monkey Springs, which was at the head of Smith Creek. And we think the name Smith comes from a family that they allowed to camp somewhere in that area. Really not many good records, but it was called Smith Creek. We have Boy Scout projects done in the 60s that talk about cleaning up Smith Creek. It very much was known as Smith Creek. Then, and over time, as the water levels began to diminish, Dry Creek came into usage. But about, I'd say 15 years ago, I noticed that TxDOT started using the term Eanes Creek. And so signs had Eanes Creek, maps had Eanes Creek. Eanes Creek technically actually is out in the Rob Roy neighborhood and runs and goes kind of northeast into the Colorado River, which is now the lake. But that was Eanes Creek. Historically, that was Eanes Creek. And this was Smith Creek. So this was important. What he did cannot be underestimated. But if we go to the next slide, this is what makes us different. And this is why we still exist 150 years later. There was a couple in the community who gave land. And remember, these are people who don't have two nickels to rub together. But they gave land to the community because they were interested in the moral training of youths in the community. And rightfully so, because it was a second marriage for her, first marriage for him. They had 9 boys. So I think they especially saw that there was there needed to be something else in the community. But this is William and Sophie Teague. And had they not done, that's the difference between Eanes and the 90 other rural schools that were established in Trace County during this decade, is they gave that 2 acres, and that 2 acres anchored, put a pin in it, gave the Eanes school a place to belong. So if we go to the next slide, this is actually a typed copy of the deed that they gave to Judge Sneed. Remember, he's the county school superintendent, so they gave it to the county school system. And they wanted it to be used for a church house and a schoolhouse. So on the next slide, I'll try and answer the question for you because it always comes up. So where was the 2 acres exactly? Well, this is another thing. I can't tell you exactly where it is because there are different references. Just to get your bearings, this is the Rock Schoolhouse on the Eanes Elementary campus. This is what was originally the Eanes Chapel, but now the art building on the Eanes Elementary campus. And this larger portion is the cemetery, the Eanes Community Cemetery, that's right there. Well, here, this, the blue outlines what the deed said, the deed we just saw on the previous page. It shows in blue, but the way that it was used is outlined in green. So the good news is the school is in that, you know, if a Venn diagram, the school is in that little bitty stretch where both of those overlap. The chapel wasn't and the cemetery wasn't at all. So I can't tell you exactly. This was a survey in 1952. And so how it was being used at that point, and that was what, 80 years after it was given. How it was being used is not how it was deeded. But generally, right there in the heart of the Eanes Elementary campus is what we can say.
Do we know when the cemetery was dedicated?
The first recorded grave in the cemetery was 1895. So yeah. 20 years later.
Yeah. I might have a question about surveys. Is there a possible reason why there's a discrepancy in the land surveys? Like it sounds like maybe they didn't have a, had a different way of surveying back then, or maybe they didn't have accurate tools, or
great, all of the above. Great question, and I don't know.
I can picture somebody going, let's go to that tree, let's go over there.
Yeah, like, it was kind of like, okay, this is the land they gave us, let's put the school right here.
Right.
Right. But I don't know. The question.
How long comes something that's more sophisticated, so it becomes altered? There's no information about how that occurred.
No, not that I've found so far, but I've also realized in doing this that there are so many questions that I don't know the answers to. So I will put that one on the list of why did the survey change over time? What we do know is that within, you know, as soon as that donation was made, within a couple of years, the community built a frame schoolhouse on that property. And even though that would burn, had moved to a log cabin, they built another frame house. In fact, this is a picture of the frame house built in 1896. For the first 65 years, Eanes students went to school in a one-room, one-teacher school that looked a lot like this. 24 by 30 board and batten construction, very, very simple. I think it's interesting that when this second frame building was built in 1896, the school trustees actually had to be the ones to build it. Wow. Yeah, so it was H.B. Marshall who married Robert Eanes' daughter and his son John. John Carlson, who actually had a dairy right here on this piece of property that we're talking about here, and his son Oscar, and Henry Johnson, whose ranch was over where Vaqueros and Woods of Westlake Heights, kind of that area, and his son Frank. They were the three school trustees, and they pretty much were in charge of the construction, which is not on the job description today, thank goodness. Just for a point of reference, the district over which Robert Eanes was originally made trustee, that District 48, only went out about as far as where Barton Creek Boulevard intersects with BK Road today. The way that was described in official documents was that was the place where the creek and the river came closest together. Mm-hmm. And sure enough, if you look on a map, you can see that if you go west, that's where they come close together, and then they kind of spread out again. And they come back together 4 or 5 miles further west, and that was the boundary of the next school district, which was the Bruton Springs or Snuffbox School. Now, I don't know why it was called the Snuffbox School. Most polite references say it was because it looked like a snuffbox. But some references say that it was because the families, including the children, used snuff quite a bit.
Wow.
And so snuff box kind of fit. Nope. Names.
I live out there, very proud of Bruton Springs, but what I've read is that it was also a church. I think it was a church actually before it became a school, and it was known as the Snuff Box Church, because the men like to sit at the end of the aisles with the open windows, spit tobacco out the window during yep. church services. And that's kind of how it became stuff.
Yeah, and all of that could be true. There was a church that was known as there was a church. It was known as Snuffbox. And, you know, there's a debate as to was the school first or was the church first. Eventually, I think it became known as Watson Springs Church. But the difference between the Eanes School and Bruton Springs, one of the big differences was that this school moved around 5-6 different locations. So it never had the continuity and the rhythm that was able to be established at the Eanes School. It did include grades 1 through 12, whereas in the 1920s, the Eanes School reduced to 1 through 7. This, I think, because it was further west, further from town, and students couldn't get to any kind of secondary education in town. It always remained 12. It struggled. This area was very thinly populated. There was a time in the 1880s when there were about 40 students, but then by the 1920s, there were only 20 or 30 students. So thinly populated over time, and they struggled economically. The county closed this school in 1949. And since we've always been rivals with those people we call the Lake Travis School District today, originally the students went to BK School, but for some reason that did not work out. And before the year was out, they had been transferred to the Eanes School, and now the borders of EISD go all the way to the western side of where they were.
Just something about one-room schools. Both my mom's parents taught one-room schools in West Texas and La Mesa. And my grandmother got her father to lie to the school district so she could get her own one-room school to teach at the age of 15 years old. This was in the early 1910s. So you can imagine in 1870, yeah, who were the teachers? Yeah. You
know? And I do realize that history is sometimes a little less accurate than we'd like for it to be, because people embroidered and embellished stories in different ways for different purposes. I do want to give a shout out, and I hope he's online today, to Todd Krickmer, one of our group, who is actually doing a lot of research on Brewton Springs. And we hope to have a program from him that will really concentrate on this school before the year is out. All right, next. We have a class picture, 1902. So again, this is a good while after 30 years into this. But if you look at the names, the Johnson family, the Marshall family, the Carlson boys aren't in here because their mother apparently took some issue with them having their picture made with some of the riffraff. Not my favorite story, but anyway. The Teagues, still some Teague children. Will Burdett, who's here in the middle, was the teacher. He was not a very popular teacher by all accounts, so he didn't stay very long. Photography was a rather new thing out in this area. Roy could give us a whole program on that. But in this area, it was not common to have photography like this. And so these two people that look like adult women, we think were adult women from the community, who jumped into the picture so that they could be recorded. That happened a lot. If you find any old family photos that have like an in-law of an in-law in the picture, and you're like, why is that person in their wedding photo? It's because people jumped in to have their picture made whenever they had the opportunity. They are standing by the side of the frame schoolhouse, which you notice was painted white when it got started. It's beginning to show a little wear here. They are standing, I think, on some of the split log benches with straight backs that were used inside the school. In this picture, most of the children have on their Sunday best. Generally, most children had two sets of clothes, one they wore during the week, every day, and then a change of clothes for Sunday. And if we go to the next slide, I just have to throw this slide in because it is my favorite in the whole Eanes history collection. This is from a little bit later, probably in the 20s, but it is students in their everyday clothes in front of their schoolhouse. The boys, overalls or coveralls. And for the girls, and this is the best example of a picture we have, the girls often had dresses or pinafores made from flour sacks that were recycled, because nothing went to waste with these families. Very, very thrifty. Nothing went to waste. That's all right.
Whoops.
You don't need to go back. I was just going to say the first kid was a Simpson kid. The second one was Chester Johnson. And in the Woods of Westlake subdivision, there is a street called Chester Wood. It is named after Chester Johnson. That was his family's ranch. And the boy and girl on the end are Reimer, the Reimer brother and sister. This is what the inside of this school looked like, looking from the back door towards the front. And it's interesting that if you find references to schools in this era, it will say almost every one-room schoolhouse had a globe, a flag, a picture of George Washington, and I can't find a globe, a flag, or a picture of George Washington in this schoolhouse. So, you know, maybe we didn't have the same things that others had for a while. We did have benches, those straight back benches. The chalkboard was a new, great invention. So that was pretty exciting. Did have the stove in the middle. And again, if you think about the months that they went to school, it was the months where they needed heat more so than air conditioning, which is good because air conditioning didn't exist. And they did have one window to get a little bit of breeze in there. Okay, funding for public education, I would say, has always been an issue. And if you look at this, Mr. Carlson, remember I told you his area was kind of around this. Well, he had the hefty tax bill of $12.35 back in 1885. I think he must have sold off some land because his tax bill was not quite so high the next year. But there wasn't a lot spent on public education either. Obviously, there was the teacher salary, but the expenses for the building for 1912, $12.35. So glad they were able to get that quart of oil and the two door hinges. So always want to keep things up to snuff. Well, speaking of teaching, meet Mary Mowinkle. I love these names, Mary Mowinkle. Remember I told you Mr. Burnett was not that popular and he didn't stay very long? Well, she came in 1903. And she was barely 17 and a half years old. She had just graduated from Thomas Springs School. If you know anything about the roads between here and Hays County, you'll know there's a Thomas Spring Road, and they had a one-room schoolhouse, and she had just graduated. So not much older, and I understand she was actually shorter than a number of the students who were in the school, because at that time, kids up until 18 were still going to the Eanes School. She was paid $30 a month. She boarded with the Henry Johnson family, the Vaqueros area Henry Johnson family, and she paid them $6 of her $30 for room and board. Well, this is a picture of her after she taught for about 3 years. Of course, I'm kidding. But I would say that I think teaching out here was probably a pretty tough gig. A pretty tough gig, especially for a 17 and a half year old. This is a picture of her at age 91. She came back to a reunion in 1975. And that's how we were able to find out so much about her experience as a teacher in the Eanes area. She actually ended up marrying Henry Johnson's younger brother. They took her to a family celebration and she met the younger brother, married, and moved out to Oak Hill. When she was in her 40s, she actually went back to school and got a degree. So education was always important to Mary. Quickly through the next one, talk about it was tough out here. It was just tough being a teacher. These rules that were published, she couldn't go in an ice cream shop. I mean, what's summer in Texas without ice cream? She had to wear at least two petticoats. She couldn't be seen without a chaperone. So anyway, a tough gig for teachers all the way around. But they did pretty miraculous things. Next slide. This is another one of my favorite. Most of you have seen this before. We think this was from the mid 20s. And again, in the 20s is when the school reduced down to 1 through 7 in its curriculum. And spelling or writing was needed to be beefed up in the curriculum. But this is Randolph Johnson. He, one of the Johnson clan, he was Chester's brother. He was Chester's brother. He's Uncle Sam. And this we think is Lady Liberty, but her name was Myrtle Denison. And the two of them grew up and married. So a sweet story that the second graders just kind of cringe a little bit and ooh and ah when you tell them that's what happens. I think this, it's not a dated photograph, but I think given the age that we've been able to document for Randolph and given the costumes, I think it was post World War I and the patriotism that emerged from that for this. In the next slide, I just wanted to acknowledge Randolph Johnson. The flag that was in the previous picture and this one, he saved that flag. And when he was an adult, he became a school trustee. And he took that flag with him to every school board meeting so they would have something to salute when they said the pledge at the beginning of the meeting. Before he died, he asked that that be given to the community via the History Center. So it's a pretty special thing. Okay. Well, in addition to the fine arts, if what we've just seen is they're the beginnings of our fine arts program, the school was also known for debate and spelling, two academic areas that were very popular during that era. We also were a baseball powerhouse. And this information comes from an interview done with the principal from back in the 1930s, Myrtle Lee Blankenship Treadwell. And Ms. Treadwell said that Oak Hill was our big rival from a baseball standpoint, and much delight was gained from beating them regularly. So some things haven't changed.
What's the date, I think, of the photograph?
This was in the 1936 yearbook. So I'm thinking spring of 35 into 36, somewhere right in there.
Yeah, I think a lot of those kids are shoeless, aren't they?
Most of them are probably shoeless. And in fact, thank you for mentioning that. That was one extraordinary thing of the class of 1902. Most of the kids had shoes on because they were wearing their Sunday clothes. That's how we know they were wearing their Sunday clothes. The everyday meant most of the kids did not wear shoes. And we see that even up in the 40s, and we'll see that in some later photographs. Yeah, so this was the baseball team. Pretty sophisticated. But the community was really into it. And volunteers from the community were really into helping the schools. I think this is pretty amazing. Again, this was a backwater out here. This was very, very rural. The children who went to the schools had been described, in fact, Ms. Treadwell used the term, she said they were the people who owned the ranches, the children of the people who owned the ranches, the children of the people who worked on the ranchers, the laborers, and then of course we have the choppers, the cedar choppers. You have a real mixture of people in the community, but there was a passion for the community that centered around the schools. That the county, these were all part of what became known as the rural common school system, the county rural common schools. And that means that the county did all the administration. Local school boards hired the teacher and took care of the building and that sort of thing. But all the administration and the supervision came from the county level. And the county evaluators would show up unannounced frequently on a school campus. But if there was ever a suspicion that the evaluators were coming out, people, adults, volunteers from the community would come and sweep the schoolyard, the dirt schoolyard. They would sweep it so that the scores would be higher. So there's always been a little bit of competition, but always a lot of pride and a lot of willingness to do things like sweeping a dirt schoolyard so that you're doing the right thing. As I mentioned, by the 1880s, there were about 90 schools in Travis County. They were educating about 4,000 kids. So it was a fairly big system. Okay, the next picture. These are the two pages for Eanes out of that consolidated yearbook. The yearbook is called The Defender. It's about that thick. Maynor which was a pretty big town in Travis, in rural Travis County, put the Defender together. So they got about half the book. They also had a fairly large school. And then each of the county schools got a page or two or three. We got two. And so some of the photographs, where's the baseball photograph? I'm pretty sure it's here. Yes, this is another view of the baseball team. This write-up talks about how beautiful and gorgeous this area is with the creeks and the rivers. It's like, come on, we need more water in this area now. So obviously very a little bit more lush than what we're used to now. They talked about how beautiful it was. They also talked about how dilapidated their school building had gotten. Remember, this is 1936. And they also celebrated the fact that the community had finally, after several bonds that did not pass in 1936, they did pass a bond to tear down the dilapidated frame building and build a rock schoolhouse that still exists today. This is the condition of the school. And I know that this picture was taken probably between 1932 and 1935, because this building in the background is the Eanes Chapel. It was that in 1928, the community decided that they wanted a separate building to use as a church. So the community started building, and literally they built it themselves with donated supplies. This building that took 5 years to build, started in 28, wasn't dedicated until 32. A lot of crowding going on here. This tower between the two is the tower for a bell that was gifted to the Eanes community from the Austin Fire Department. The fire department gave it to Eanes, again, the country bumpkins who didn't have much, because they didn't need it anymore. They had gotten electricity shortly after the turn of the century. And so all of their alarm systems were electrified. They didn't need this old-fashioned bell anymore. So they gave it to the folks out in the Eanes community to ring people in on Sunday and also to ring the children in during the week. Love that story.
What do you reckon happened to that bell?
I'm gonna show you that bell and exactly where it is in just a minute. So the area got electricity in 33. The Eanes School organized a parent-teacher association in 34. They did a lot of things. They dug a water well, which was really handy because at that point, Smith Creek was so polluted because there were enough animals, free-range animals, in the on the ranches by this time, that Smith Creek was polluted and couldn't drink it. So they dug a well. They started a hot lunch program, which was part of the federal programs during the Depression. And each Monday, a teacher would drive into Austin and pick up supplies for lunch for the week. And generally, those supplies were cornbread, beans, grapefruit, and chocolate pudding every day. What a combination. But I think one of the reasons that it was important when they organized was that they lobbied for a new building, that they organized and began to lobby the community for a new building, and they were successful because, as I mentioned, in April 1936, voters approved $3,500 to build a rock schoolhouse. Next picture. And here's the product of their work. It was stone, just like the chapel, but it wasn't built by volunteers. It was built by professional stonemasons. Edward Johnson, part of the Johnson group, thereby Vaqueros, was a stonemason, and he did most of this work. We have the trowel that he used when he built this building. And his son Cecil tells the story of how he received 100 pennies a week if he would go behind his father and brush the mortar to make it nice and smooth. The Dodge and the Model T, we think probably belong to the staff members who did not live in the community. And probably the Model T had upholstery that was made from mohair from the Angora goats that were raised on the Marshall Ranch right here in this area. It's a whole nother story. Well, this talks about the first day of school in our new rock schoolhouse, 1937, fall 1937. There were two teachers because we had graduated from one-room schoolhouse to two-room schoolhouse. Two teachers, Nellie Bell Clunker. Isn't that the best school teacher name ever? She had graduated from the University of Texas, so very much a step up from Thomas Springs High School, and she was paid $80 a month. So times were improving. She taught in the left-hand room, which was called the little room, and that's where the students in grades 1 through 4 were. Ms. Landers, who also served as principal, taught the older students in the right-hand room. And the next picture shows you what I think is the very first day of school, schoolhouse. Remember, they're going to school about 8 months out of the year now, but still it was a little bit cooler, probably October, or maybe even into November when school got started. And so you've got the littles lined up here in front of Nellie Bell, and you've got the older students. Now, even by this time, I've mentioned that the curriculum was narrowed down to 1st through 7th grade. That did not mean that all of the students were 6 through, say, age 12 or so. That there are records of people who were 18 who were still finishing the 7th grade. So a wide range of children there. And I had to put this picture in. This is in front of the Old Rock Schoolhouse on the front porch. This became the traditional place where class pictures were taken. And when we take the Eanes second graders on field trips to the history complex now, they line up just like this so they can have their picture taken in the Eanes spot. Next slide shows the playground. You know, now we have million-dollar playgrounds at all of our elementary schools. But in the 1940s, it was pretty much a shaded oak-shaded area with a lot of construction rubble out front. But the kids certainly had a good time. A rare snowstorm, this is documented as 1941, the kids having a grand time. And that is the chapel you see behind, not the schoolhouse. That's the chapel with the bell tower over to the left. And then the next slide. Even though they had the school lunch program, some people chose to bring their lunch from home, as it still happens today. And so these are children who are using the banks of Smith Creek as their cafeteria. They probably, in the brown sacks that you see, have biscuits, either cold fried chicken or bacon, and a baked sweet potato. That was a typical thing that would carry and come to school with them. And end of school was always a time to celebrate. I think that's the day that most children still love, the day that you get out of school for the summer. And this was in 1941 as well. And pop was the real treat they have. Notice, no shoes. Again, into the 1940s.
I think they're drinking shine, but the boy in the middle, kind of the leader there, the very, if you notice, he's got a artificial leg on his right side.
Yeah. Yep. And he has two bottles of pop.
And he's got a great attitude.
Yeah. It's like, what the heck? What the heck? Okay, well, I mentioned the BK Road was paved in 1936. Well, that meant that automobiles, including trucks, that kind of transportation was entering into the area. Lake Austin was built in 1940, and then 10 years later, the low water crossing. So things were beginning to get a little bit easier from a transportation standpoint. So in 1943, the county, as one of the services that they provided to their rural common schools, began to transport the older students from the Eanes school area into town. They went to Allen Junior High and Austin Senior High. And then in 1960, when O'Henry was built, they started going to O'Henry Junior High and continued at Austin Senior High. As a trustee, this picture scares me to death because this was the bus they used. It was a flatbed with slatted sides, and they pulled a tarp over. This is actually a picture of a trip to San Antonio. Can you imagine going to San Antonio in that and getting back safely? Even walking down that ladder with no handrails or anything. But that, I mean, that's how the world was. So that was our first bus. But as time went on, we got other buses. And did any of you know Della?
Rode her bus for years.
Oh, okay.
She was a no-nonsense bus driver. The first route we used to go down, Bee Cave, and they switched because we went to Knollwood and then Oldkett, and then we turned around. But there was one time that they switched to Bee Cave when they switched the route, and she actually stopped the bus on 360 and told the kid to get off. And they had to walk the rest of the way home.
Whoa.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she did. I mean, you couldn't do that today, but she did that.
Back then, you could do that.
Yeah.
What year was that?
That was probably about 72, 73.
I just want to make sure with my son.
Oh, yeah.
he was a little late.
Well, I can still tell you who it is, but I'm not going to tell you who it was. I can tell you.
Well, early 70s, I lived across the street from Scott and a couple years behind him in school, but Della would drive us from Eanes down Bee Caves to across from the county line to Old Camelot, or as they call it, New Camelot. And somehow in that mile and a half, kids would upset her so much, she'd pull over on the side of Bee Caves Road, which is a two-lane little street, and she'd make kids get out, and she'd drive off and leave them.
Yep.
And parents thought it was the greatest thing of all time.
Yep.
It had only been a couple of minutes. I look back and I go, what could have got her so mad? But she couldn't handle it.
Oh, interesting.
I do have to tell you one quick thing. This is fun because in the new Camelot, with all those like fourplexes are on the hill, we first moved out there, none of that existed. It was all, and then when they cut that through, because she used to go down to the bottom on Castle Ridge and turn around. She had to pull the bus back up, and then come back around on Castle Ridge because it was a dead end. And when they put those apartments up there on Forbes, but you came over the top of the hill, she'd stop. Let all them out, and then you came when there's a steep hill, and she would floor that thing. And we loved to sit in the back of the bus because there are no seat belts, and sit in the very back, and she'd come flying over the hill. You could literally, you would bounce up and almost like hit your hands on the ceiling because she'd come over the top of that thing, and you'd fly like on a roller coaster. She was like, oh yes, don't ever get hurt, but it was kind of a fun thing. You gotta get the back of the bus to fly up on the
ceiling. She also supposedly had an award for the longest bus driver without, safety and everything. Yeah. And she drove the football teams and the band. She was the driver.
Yeah. She started in 1950, and then she was not the primary driver for 40 years. She evolved into her roles and eventually was a bus monitor and the helper and that sort of thing. But 40 years in transportation, which we think is a record for a transportation employee or school district in Texas.
We were Route 1, so by the way.
You were what?
We were Route 1. There were 11 bus routes, and we were Route 1. So.
Okay. Well, when she first started driving, she was the only, she did the only route, and it took her 2.5 hours. Whoa. Because she would start from her house, which is just, was off Bee Cave Road, just past where 360 is. And she would go out to Common Fords and do an in and out. She would do River Hills, an in and out. She would then come down and do an in and out basically on the beginnings of Redbud. Then she would go through the Rollingwood area. She would bring the younger children and drop them at the Eanes School. And then she would go back east, go through Zilker Park, to Austin High School and Allen Junior High, drop those children, and then go back home. So that was 2.5 hours every way. And she did that when her children were babies, and she put them in a carrier and hang it on the back of her seat. Talk about no seatbelts. So Della is pretty, has a lot of notoriety. I love it that the transportation area, in their employee lounge, basically picnic tables outside, for years had a big sign that said Della's Den, and that was in her honor. Okay, this Happy Kids. In modern desks, oh my gosh, they aren't sitting on those hardback benches anymore. This is in what would have been the big room in that rock schoolhouse, the one on the right-hand side. And we think it's probably mid-50s. The reason I think it's the room on the right is because this wall back here was collapsible. Not collapsible, but retractable, I guess, folded up. It was an early, early version of how you could open one room to the other. You know, that became very, very popular in school architecture into the 70s and the 80s, but this was a very, very early version. And the reason that is there is because the next slide will show us that the two-room Eanes schoolhouse got too small. Kids sitting on the floor. Remember, we said Bruton Springs closed in 1950. So that school closed. And even though it wasn't a ton of kids, it was still another 30 or so kids. The low water crossing had opened up. So people were beginning to move this way. So in 1950, we needed another room on the Eanes school. And the wing was added with lots of windows. The next slide. Is from that era. Who knows cars well enough to know what year that car might? I'm thinking this might be the 60s, but this is the Eanes Rock Schoolhouse that was the main campus, if you will, because in 1936, I'm sorry, in 1953, the school district purchased the 7 acres of land that were between where the Rock Schoolhouse is and Bee Cave Road. So they knew expansion was coming, and in 1953 is when they built this. This, by the way, would have been Eanes School Road, which originally went smack through the middle of campus from Bee Cave Road all the way past the school. In the 60s, when pods of classrooms were built on the Eanes campus, that blocked off Eanes School Road from Bee Cave Road. So Campcraft became the main way to go south. Campcraft did a bootleg and still does to this day with the circle pickup area, bootlegged in. So Eanes School Road did that bootleg and then still ran through campus past the school. When in 1991, when the gymnasium and cafeteria and all of those large buildings were built on the south end of the Eanes campus, that's when Eanes School Road was truncated and really became a driveway on the Eanes campus. Okay, I mentioned the purchase of the acreage. By 1956, Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church had really taken ownership, and the chapel that had been the Eanes Chapel had evolved into Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church. They decided to build on a separate piece of property, which is actually where Treaty Oak Bank and now Chamber of Commerce offices are in the building at Westlake Drive and Bee Cave Road. They decided to move, and so the school district bought their interest in the chapel building. Remember that building that had been built by hand from 1928 to 1932. The school district did put lots of windows in it and added an extension for bathrooms and storage. So made it part of the school. I think it was during this era that this sign, the Eanes School, notice it doesn't say Eanes Elementary School because that didn't exist. in 1956. It's just the Eanes School, what it had been known as. These are concrete letters that are still in front of the school today. And they were poured by Fred Bullion, who was a dairyman.
Bullion.
Thank you. Bullion, who's Bullion Road, right down by the Randall Shopping Center. That was his dairy area. And he must have used a lot of concrete because he also marked the entrance to his dairy as Bullion Place in big letters like this. That no longer exists, okay? And Fred must have been a character because when the purchase of that chapel went through to the school district, he signed for the church and he signed for the school. I don't think you could get away with that these days from a legal standpoint, but he signed for both of them. And Jeffrey, to your question about what happened to that bell moved with Westlake Hills Presbyterian Church. I don't know if they ever hung it.
Oh, yeah.
At the old building on Westlake Drive.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, I don't know if they, but now it is in front of their sanctuary at their building out at Barton Creek Boulevard. Very definitely there. It's the first thing you see when you drive up. Okay. So we've had a pretty great run with these rural common schools. It worked really well for the area out here. A lot of sense of community, a lot of support from the county. But state law began to change, and in 1957, the community had a pretty painful decision to make. No more county schools, so no more support from the county. Could we become an independent school district in our own right, or did we need to merge with another entity? Our choice was really Austin ISD, or not. Which of those two things? Well, the voters decided pretty decisively. There were only about 250 people who voted, but notice the, I do. 207 to 48. It's kind of like, not just no, but hell no. We want to be our own thing. We want to be independent. Now, at the same time, Oak Hill and Manshack, who had merged, those two schools had merged earlier, they voted the opposite way. They voted to go with Austin. And that is why that the Barton Creek Estates area goes to Austin High. That's part of AISD. It's on the other side of Barton Creek because it was part of the Oak Hill School District way back at the school. I've always been told that they drive, most of them drive over, the one who live in, that they drive through our district. They go to AISD.
They definitely go to AISD.
And I always thought, oh, okay, what's the difference between our community and their community? What I've been able to find out is that they were in pretty rough economic straits. It was really an economic decision. It wasn't an emotional decision about we're a community and we want to stay together. For them, it was strictly economics, and they couldn't. There was no way they could afford to do it. And a lot of that has to do with the land ownership and who was voting and who was willing to raise taxes and that sort of thing. But our community, from what I understand, was barely able financially to do it, but they said, we're going to figure this out. So they voted to become an independent school district. And that's when the ISD terminology started being used. The school district, the trustees was increased to 7 from 3. Eanes School became Eanes Elementary School. And there was a formalization of our secondary students who were being bused over to Austin. And EISD had to pay tuition for those students who were going there.
I think point out really quickly, I see this common error made in, I guess, children or grandchildren of people in obituaries, but Allen Junior High is actually A-L-L-A-N.
A-N, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
Good proofreading, Scott.
Okay. Very good.
What was the trying point? I see that a lot.
Right. I got in trouble when I wrote my my father's obituary and said his mother was Hattie, was Harriet, thinking that Hattie, which we called her, was a nickname. But it wasn't, it was her real name.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so I got in real trouble. Thank you for that. next slide. So now we're into the 60s, and the community passed a couple of bonds because more and more people are beginning to move out here. It wasn't a rush yet. It was still kind of a slow trickle. By 62, there were 300 students, and they thought they had a modern cafeteria. That was the exciting thing, and a school safety program, a safety patrol. So things were going really well. Did any of you ever know Hilton Pancratz? So we probably got some stories about Mr. Pancratz.
Well, he's kind of, one of his sons was in my, I knew his daughter well, and his son was in my grade. So
his daughter was in my grade.
Yeah. A lot of stories there that we won't take time to share today. But it was interesting that if you look at the literature, everybody here was convinced that Eanes Elementary was done by 1969. It's all built out. We won't need any more space. It's done. Well, about that time, Austin Independent School District hit the community with another big decision. So the end of the story was not finished at all. That Austin decided they didn't have room. They were growing. Austin was growing. Their schools were becoming crowded. They didn't have room at Austin High for our second year students. Now there was some talk, okay, we might be able to send them somewhere else, but when you think about the bus, the 2.5 hour bus ride, and then the uncertainty of that, as well as the time and distance of that. So there wasn't much, or there was a lot of controversy actually in the neighborhood, but nobody knew exactly what Austin was going to do over the long haul. So the school board set up a committee with 110 members. Now remember, there were only 150 voters a decade before, and this committee had 110 members. But they did, after a lot of consideration, make a recommendation that the trustees, quote, adopt a program that would provide a junior senior high school of above average quality. Let's be clear, above average quality. The high standards of excellence prevailing now must be maintained. So that started a debate in the community. And boy, do I understand it was a debate. We think we have arguments today. Apparently this one was a doozy. Remember, at this time, everybody knew everybody else. And there were definitely two sides of this argument. The people who wanted to stay independent and build facilities, they were kind of those people who probably voted, hell no, we want to be independent a decade earlier. They also were very suspect of Austin, the big city. You still hear some of that out here today. You know, don't want the big city telling us what to do. There also was an amazing amount of pride in the quality that had been developed at Eanes Elementary and the education that this backwater community, backwater, rural, poor community was able to establish. On the other hand, there were folks who really wanted us to merge with AISD because we knew what that was. Kids been going over there. We think they have quality. We're not sure that just because you have that elementary school, we can replicate that at the high school level. And also they were very hesitant to take on debt. So these were the arguments. There's a fabulous article in the Statesman. It was literally an entire page of the newspaper taken up with the two sides and the pros and the cons.
There is another aspect which is not so comfortable to think about. And that is that this community was all white, and to have its own independent school district meant an all white school district. There was also that aspect in that decision.
And people ask me about that, and I have looked and looked for any documentation or anybody who was saying that out loud. I think you're right, but nobody was saying that out loud. The way they would couch it was, we're not sure what's going to happen in AISD. So
you have to remember too, and this I think was brought when I mentioned my presentation, it's a whole other discussion, but I remember that busing was being discussed and was happening because of that during this time. So there was concern in here, not so much the school, but there was concern among the parents about kids being shipped all the way across town, sitting in buses for not getting home until 6 and 6:30 in the evening, being picked up at 6 o'clock in the morning and being gone for 12 hours a day, sitting on buses. Because there was talk about sending kids, you know, in different schools across Austin.
Yeah,
so that was part of that issue too.
And you can find slight references because there was some speculation that they might go to Crockett or might go to Travis and just the time and energy. But I think you're right, Jeffrey, that there likely was an undercurrent of what does that mean in terms of diversity. But the school board took the recommendation of this 110 person committee. And next slide. They called a bond election for almost $3 million. And it was a very hotly contested election, highest voter turnout anybody had seen. Again, think about the numbers of 10 years previous. But the bond passed. It was pretty close, 700 and something to close to 600. So pretty close, but it passed. And so the construction began. There actually was a construction contract that was awarded. And even after the construction contract was awarded, the group of citizens who wanted to merge with AISD had not given up. And they forced a second election by petition. They got enough signatures to force another election in April after that contract had been let in March, and there was a second vote. And in the second vote, the 1,000 to 600, so a 400 vote spread. So clearly more people became engaged and the community said more loudly, we still want to stay independent. We still want to do it our way. And I think this is great that the second vote was in early April. By the end of April, the booster club at the high school had formed, and boy, everybody was having a grand time getting ready for this great new high school. So the school board bought 48 acres from the Johnson family. You've heard their name. This is Frank Johnson, who we've seen in other pictures. He was the father of Randolph, father of Chester. He is plowing his corn and his cotton field. This is the field that now is Ebbie Neptune Field in the middle of Chaparral Stadium at the high school. So a great picture of that evolution. The first booster club meeting, these are minutes from the first booster club meeting. And the superintendent said, yes, we will have class officers and we will have cheerleaders. And when we hire a band director, we'll start buying instruments. And when we hire a football coach, we'll start buying uniforms. Just be calm. We're going to do all of that, but it's going to take us a couple of minutes here. So just really an amazing superintendent's report in those minutes of the first booster club meeting. The school board named the high school Westlake, and of interest, it's one word, Westlake, whereas Westlake Hills had been two words. So Westlake, that was a pretty big thing. The colors, red, white, and blue. Best story I found is that one of the school board members was an SMU alum. And that's where the red, white, and blue came from. The mascot, Chaparral. Again, best story. And sometimes with history, you have to get six or seven different stories and then figure out which one probably has the most momentum. Chaparral's because when they went to Farmer Johnson's property, there were Chaparrals everywhere. And they said, they're big, they're strong, they're fast. Why not? Let's be the Chaparrals. And the emblem, and Colleen, if we could go back, this is a later picture. This is later in the 70s because the school didn't start with stadium. But this is the original emblem that a dad by the name of Dwayne pinned. And he brought it to this first booster club meeting, and they actually tabled it because they were nervous that the school board had named the mascot Chaparral, and this looks surprisingly like a roadrunner. So they weren't sure how to navigate those politics, so they just tabled it to talk about it later.
And FYI, that picture is actually from the mid-80s, because the original stadium, when you walked in, you walked on the ground level, and the seats were down from the ground level there. So the original stadium, like we see you walk in, that was after the first stadium expansion there in the early 80s.
Early 80s, very good. But going back in our timeline, this booster club was before there was even a building or anything at all, because, next slide, Westlake High School actually opened back at that Eanes Elementary campus. Remember 1969 was going to be when that campus was just finished? Well, the good news was it wasn't finished. And so there was a south area that was treed and had been used as a playground. The school board bought 14 beige portable classrooms. And school started that fall for Westlake High School in those beige portables that they had bought with the promise that they would resell or sell them back to the original seller, 70 cents on the dollar, 1 year later. So a tight timetable. It's like not much time to get this building built.
Let me tell you, just really quickly, it's interesting your note about the Roadrunner, the issue with that, because in the early years, they actually used Chaparral and Roadrunner interchangeably. Like the first school newspaper was the Roadrunner Express.
That's
and references, and you see on signs in the school, Roadrunners do this and that. So it's funny that was an issue within the first several years, and it kind of died out by the late 70s, the use of the Roadrunner. So,
absolutely. In fact, if we go to this next slide, real quickly, a great fundraiser. How many of you have these in your, Jeffrey, I know, has these are little bricks. They're about this size. And these were auctioned off, or they were sold at a bricklaying party that first fall. Again, the building is, the land is being cleared, but the school is being held down on the Eanes Elementary campus. Rooster Andrews, Cactus Pryor, every celebrity contact in the book was used. And
I'm sorry to interrupt, but
no, please.
I laid the second brick. They auctioned real bricks.
Oh, wow.
And the first brick went for $45. The second brick went for $5.
Okay.
And that's how I got in on that second brick.
Okay. For those of you online, that was Jeffrey Dochin saying that he actually laid the second brick. If Rooster Andrews mortared the first brick, he paid $45. Rooster paid $45, and then Jeffrey got the second brick for $5 and was able to brick that in. I had to share this picture with you because this is the class of 1970. They graduated never having been on the high school campus. Remember, their senior year was in the portable buildings. These were kids who had done ninth grade at O'Henry in AISD. They had done their 10th and 11th grade years at Austin High School, and they had done their 12th grade year in the portables. Talk about some flexible kids. I loved this. They put it in their annual. I was the pioneer of a new day. Through chaos and controversy, I blazed a trail of new traditions. Rugged and steep, the path led beyond my dreams.
Where do you think that's taken with that rock wall?
I think that's a great question. I had never noticed this until I enlarged the photo to make a slide of it. But I think this is on what became known as the Oliver Ranch. It was originally owned by Plato Martinez. We did have Hispanics in the area throughout our history. And Clayton Martinez bought some of Robert Eanes' land, which is now, it's on the south side of Eanes School Road, right there in back of Eanes Elementary. And this dry stack, Mexican style fence, gorgeous historic fence, is still there. And it was built in 1888 by Clayton Martinez. Later on, it came into the possession of the Oliver family. And the reason I think this might be that, I think this wagon is the same wagon that B.G. Oliver donated to the History Center in 1992, and the students in the industrial arts class is restored at Westlake High School, and we now have in a little barn, really a shed, on the Eanes campus that we show to the students as the example of the prairie schooner, the style of prairie schooner that Robert Eanes would have migrated to Texas in. So she said that she had it out in her front yard. So between the fence and the, I think that's where that picture was taken. There were 40 graduates that first year. The next year, and I realize this picture is a little bit later than 1970, but this is what the original building looked like. And as I was doing this research, I found a controversy that I didn't know was a controversy. Imagine that in this area. And that is the next slide. Which class has the real claim on who the first class was at Westlake High School? I just assumed those 43 kids in the picture I just showed you were the first class. I've been acting all this time like they were the first class because to me they were. But I have since learned that the kids who graduated in 1971 who were in that building in the last slide, they claimed that they were the first class because they were the first in the new digs. This year, the class of 1972 is having a big reunion, their 50th. And they are so excited because they were the first class to graduate from Westlake High School. And I'm like, been a little awkward, but it's like I realized they are claiming that they are the first to go all 3 years. And that's because in AISD, ninth grade was not part of high school. So to them, high school was 10 through 12, and they went all 3 years at Westlake. So they think they're the first class, and they're claiming it, by golly. Well, just some things that I was reading, some memoirs from different students reading last week who graduated in 1973. One reason they were so committed as alumni is because they were the first class. They were the first class to go through all 4 years in Westlake. So they claimed to be the first. So I don't know who you want to think is the first class, but we've got several for you to choose from. Real quickly, because I know our time's getting short, but back to that emblem. These are some of the first decals of the first 5 or 6 years. You notice at first it really was the beep, beep, a roadrunner. Still a little bit cartoonish, began to look more like a bird over time. Then by the 80s, I think this it was probably mid 80s when this picture was taken, the costume was much more like a bird. And in fact, Mr. Gardner, who was the German teacher for a year, Herr Gardner, was the mascot underneath the bird costume. And he told stories of how he used brown shag carpeting and built this big tail, and he connected it with fishing wire so that he could move the tail with a fishing wire on either side of his neck. And he wore Converse high top basketball shoes that he had dyed yellow and brown tights. So
you still need to include the original mascot in your photos, though. I think I sent those to you.
You
it's,
did.
It's, yeah, it's made by the art department, and it was those, it was a paper mache, the body, the wings, and then it had a long neck, and it had the head on the top, and it had a pole. Person would put it over the top of them, they would turn the head like that in the pole. It was just a paper mache thing that obviously they couldn't wear it during rainy games, but you know, they
a big Pez dispenser.
Yeah, I mean, it looked like the deep roadrunner is what it did. So
we always had hippie teachers, but Herr Gardner by far was the first punk rock teacher.
Oh, okay, I can't
imagine how just high energy and crazy this guy dressed and acted. And Storman Norman Fleeman was the principal, who was the ultimate straight guy, the absolute straight guy. And when Herr Gardner would get in that costume, he would just terrorize Norman Fleeman. And of course, the kids just loved it. But Herr Gardner was a huge influence in that time frame.
Yeah, yeah. And I will say I saw the remnants of that costume when the stadium was rededicated. And the field name for Ebby Neptune, that was in September of 2002. Herr Gardner actually put together most of his original costume and came to share that with us. At that celebration of the rededication of the stadium in 2002, the newest mascot version was introduced. And this is Chips and Queso. That came about as a result of a student contest. And apparently Chips and Queso won, and so they had to scramble and say, okay, we'll have two, because Chips and Queso are two different things. So that's how we got to Chips and Queso, and they are still our mascots today. But just what Scott was referring to, the Roadrunner Express was the name of the original newspaper, and that lasted for a couple of years. I love this because apparently 1973 must have been when the voting age or the drinking age was changed. It changed in Texas, and so you had to be 21, unfortunately. It was 1974 when it converted. And this next picture, this is not the first annual cover, but this was so great from a chaparral standpoint, I had to share it with you.
Super chap.
1975. And again, it's back to a little bit of that cartoonish Roadrunner type of artwork. Great cover for the El Paisano, which has two meanings in Spanish. It can either be friend, or it can mean chaparral, the bird. So, and it also can mean habitat, where chaparral bushes grow. So all three of those things, the name El Paisano is kind of
different. It also means, can mean countryman, like a country. Mm-hmm. País is a country in Spanish, and El Paisano means the country, a citizen of a country. So it's also mean like citizen of Westlake High School.
Yeah. But it kind of, all of those, all of the meanings kind of work. This next picture, I couldn't leave this out. I don't want to get too much into Westlake High School, but I couldn't leave this out. This is the smoking area. And it's really hilarious. Somebody on Facebook sent me a thing a couple of weeks ago because they knew I liked school humor. And it's a young girl escorting somebody who's about my age. And the person my age is saying, you know, when I was in high school, we had a smoking section. And the young girl is saying, oh, Nana, come on, let's get you back to bed. Because clearly it's hard to believe that a school had an official smoking section, but this was our official smoking section, which I believe was kind of off the cafeteria.
In between the commons and the library.
In the library.
Well, it actually moved a couple of times because it was, and then it moved back to where it was originally there. And then they moved it to where the band hall, where the library is, the band, old band hall, mm-hmm. with the cafeteria. And then it moved it to that section. They originally moved it because people were complaining because they had to walk through the smoke from the main building to the library. So they moved it back kind of off that area. So
certainly a popular place.
And it was students and teachers. They all sat together and smoked.
Yeah.
Okay, a different way of establishing a relationship.
Yes,
and I had to include this quote from Tootie Bird about how we got hippies, kickers, and nerds. An eclectic group, as has always been out here. Next slide. And I show this, it's not a very good slide, but just to show how when the high school was carved out of the Johnson Ranch, he was in the middle of nowhere. I don't know that I'd call this wilderness, but I'd certainly call it undeveloped farmland, undeveloped ranch land. There was nothing here, but a lot of land that could be developed for homes. And that happened very, very quickly after 1970. The Mopac Bridge was opened up, 360 was completed, the 360 Bridge. Neighborhoods began developing in the early 70s, like Lost Creek, with lots and lots of homes. Next slide. So Westlake, as we mentioned, the building itself opened. It did open that next fall, in fall of 1970. And students from grades 7 through 12 were in the building. 7 and 8 in junior high school, 9 through 12 in as senior high school. And I have this great newsletter that has the architectural plans and things like that, if you want to look at it afterwards, that shows the artist rendering of what the junior, senior high school is going to look like.
Just kind of quick note, junior high and high school did not over. We actually had 7 periods of junior high and 6 high school. So the only time we were in the hallway at the same time was beginning in the school and then 4th period. We actually were all in the hallway at the same time. Other than that, there were different bell schedules. So
I was going to say the parents probably liked that.
Oh, yes, they loved that. Yeah, I think, yes. Exactly.
Something that today just would not happen was that as more and more students came to the elementary campus and crowding happened at the Eanes campus, they would just take a grade level and move them up to the high school and put them in portables. So the 6th grade moved up, and Scott helped me with this earlier last week. 5th grade did move. We don't think they stayed more than about a semester because there weren't many 5th grade parents who really wanted their kids with the smoking area close by. So that didn't last very long, but it was kind of makeshift until Hill Country Middle School opened in 1975 with 5th through 8th. Now a traditional middle school is 6th through 8th, but it opened with 5th through 8th. And a very, very important thing happened in 1974, I think, and that is that Dr. Don Rogers became superintendent out here. There had been 5 superintendents between when the ISD was formed, which would have been in 1957, and 1974. Nobody who really stayed for an extended period of time. Dr. Rogers came and gave 17 years of his professional life to this district. And what a difference that made.
Ellen, I was in that first class or first 7th grade class at the Hill Country in 75, 5th grade at Eanes, 6th grade at the high school, and then 7th when we opened. And I was on the first play, the kickoff against Gonzales. I think I was the first ball carrier. But the funny thing about that we talked about was somebody in California decided that the problem with education was walls. So they built a 5th grade room, 6th grade, 7th, 8th grade, just these giant open air that were a massive disaster. Because you imagine teaching junior high in an open ballroom, it was so loud, they tried to do partitions, and instantly that next summer they came in and
built walls.
Yeah. What were we thinking? Okay, well, I can tell you what the community was thinking. The operating principle, and this was a total surprise to me. The operating principle of the 80s and 90s, as Eanes dealt with growth, was keep all the kids together. From the beginning, it was keep all the kids together. That a lot of us are aware of the one high school, two high school fights of 20 some odd years ago. I thought it was a new issue at that point. It goes all the way back to when we were building schools, and that is, how do we keep the kids together? The community really wanted all the kids, no matter which neighborhood they lived in, no matter what their background, wanted them in the same, to have the same experience and be together. So I included this name of the property where Cedar Creek now stands. French Creek Drive, does anybody remember when it was called French Creek Drive? Pinnacle didn't exist, and Walsh Charlton didn't go that far. So it was French Creek Drive and Stone Ridge Boulevard was the corner where Cedar Creek is today. It opened in 1978, drawing 3rd and 4th graders from Eanes Elementary and the 5th grade from Hill Country. So again, the operating principle was keep the kids together. Kindergarten, 1st and 2nd grade were Eanes, 3rd through 5th at Cedar Creek, middle school, and then high school. Growth was beginning to really pick up. These numbers show about a 200 student increase in 1 year. That's a lot for a school district of this size. Next slide. So the building continued. That the school board purchased almost 29 acres off of 360. And I think this is hilarious. They purchased it. This is where Valley View and the Forest Trail are today. And they purchased it because that site was deemed accessible from anywhere in the district. without traffic congestion. You don't know what you don't know. Valley View opened in 1982. And again, the operating principle, keep the kids together. So I was shocked by this. I had no idea that when Valley View opened, kindergarten and first grade stayed at Eanes. It was second and third grade that went to Valley View. And then the fourth and fifth graders stayed at Cedar Creek. And it was called Cedar Creek Intermediate School for a couple of years. Again, keep the kids together. That allowed kindergarten to expand to a full day program, 1982. And if you look at the growth by this point, this is what, 5 years later, there was an increase in 400 students in 1 year. So you can see how the growth was beginning to really, really speed up, particularly at the elementary level. And so the next slide, a second elementary school was built on that 29 acres. When it was bought, they said, we're definitely gonna build one and maybe build two. And I've been told that there was actually discussion that maybe we just build five grade levels and have a first grade campus, a second grade campus, a third grade. But everybody decided that was getting a bit excessive. So when this fourth elementary school opened, it was decided to pair schools. And that's when Eanes and Cedar Creek were paired and Valley View and Forest Trail were paired.
Ellen, I think that's why Forest Trail was built there, because that was originally planned to add just another, let's open up another grade of Forest Trail in the process. I think that's, it kind of said this is not practical anymore. So.
And if you look at the architecture of those two schools, right. So very different. You can tell they were built for different age children. Yes. Really kind of amazing. During this period, there were also a number of additions that were made at the high school, which was good because the high school population was growing. So the squeeze came, next slide, for middle school. And they started talking about a school out west. The school board bought what was called the Frisham Track near Patterson Lane, and it was proposed that there would be a second middle school there. The community actually debated, again, keep the kids together. The community debated putting the sixth and seventh grade together at one middle school and having the eighth and ninth grade together at the other middle school. I found that fascinating. But you remember what happened in 1985 that affected the real estate market in Austin particularly negatively?
The savings and loan bust
and all of that. And there was a real estate nosedive in 1985, which really flattened growth. Eanes had been having anywhere from 6.5% to 11.5% growth every year. And then all of a sudden, whoo, stopped. Came back up, but it stopped for that year. So the community kind of had to do a double take, and they actually postponed the opening of West Ridge for a year till 1997. And they decided to go with a typical configuration. 360 was the dividing line. All the kids west would go to that new school out west. All the students east would continue to go to Hill Country. I threw these in because it's just so much fun. And I haven't been able to find this on most of the schools. It seems like every school went through a process where the students came up with ideas, the administration of the school would narrow down the choices, then give them back to the students and their families to vote. And that's how most of the mascots and the colors and the names, even the names of the schools, but I hadn't been able to find much of that information. But through this process in West Ridge, we could have had West Ridge, Silver Creek, or Canyon Ridge. We could have been the Wildcats, the Jaguars, or the Gators. I'm glad they went with the native animals. And then three different color recommendations. So kind of fun to actually find those. So it did open, and next slide. The other thing that happened in mid-80s, 1986, which was actually written about in the Eanes ISD newsletter, And in this article, it says this is a, quote, dream come true for a lot of people in the community. And what that meant was the 10 acres that were across Westlake High Drive, now West Bank Drive, from the high school. In fact, it's the piece that's just right behind us here. That 10 acres was land that would allow the high school to expand, which meant we could keep one high school and the kids could stay together. And this was in the mid 80s that people were, it was a dream come true that we could expand the high school and keep the kids together.
It was the, it was either Dr. Cannon or Dr. Buchanan that owned that and went to church with us at Park Hills. And that was a very contentious purchase.
Yeah.
Because they did not want to do it.
I thought theirs was the second, the Buchanan track. I thought theirs was the second one.
Next to the guts,
The
whole thing was pretty contentious back
Pretty
then.
Contentious. But some people loved it because that meant that the high school could expand. Okay. But there's still pressure on the elementary school. And Dr. Rogers is quoted as saying, we're educating 2,252 elementary students with diverse needs in facilities erected to house a homogeneous population of 2,048. I thought it was really interesting how he not only said we have more than capacity allows, but we also have a much more diverse population that we're trying to take care of. So the next slide will show the big decision in 1991. You know, they hadn't opened a high school, they hadn't opened a school for 5 years now. Wow, that was pretty surprising. But Barton Creek Elementary, which was originally working title was Patterson Lane Elementary, did open, and the school board decided to open it as a K through five. It seems to me from looking at the district newsletters that the recommendation to the board was to change all of the elementary schools at that point. And the board did not do it. So I think they voted against the administration's recommendation and they kept the other schools paired, but let Barton Creek open with that different configuration. And so it would be almost a decade later when that pairing of our elementary schools ended. By this time, Robin Hood school finance system had come into play and things were getting a little tricky. So the Eanes Education Foundation, the notion of a foundation came into being, and it was Dr. Rogers, it was Westridge principal, Dr. Carol McKenzie by that time, and Coco Blackburn, one of the residents of the area who really put the vision for the foundation. This is a list of foundation board members from those early days. I thought it was great that they made their first donation, their first grant to the school district, and called it a part of the 120th anniversary celebration of the school, since we're doing our 150th now. Their first donation was at the 120th, and it was $14,000, which was greatly appreciated. And I will have to editorialize and say, here we are 30 years later, our 150th year, and their gift to us is more like $2.5 million. Wow. And we are extraordinarily grateful for the vision that was seen that long ago. Then the 1990s brought change again. And I almost call this the tumultuous decade because I didn't live here then. I didn't move here until the end of that decade, but it sure seems like a lot of things changed. First of all, Dr. Rogers retired and Dr. John Phillips was hired from Atlanta. He came in and of course, first thing he did was have a new strategic plan and a new mission statement for the school. All of the elementary schools were changed pretty quickly after his arrival to the K-5 configuration. The Balcones Cooperative that we had led, which provided administration for special education services across 7 school districts, was dissolved. And so we had to do a lot of work to recalibrate and make sure that we had the administrative manpower locally to take care of all of that. And I had to let you know that the no smoking policy was implemented in 1990. All these were in 1993, actually. So I guess I guess that smoking area had to go in 1993. So we closed out the century with a huge battle over whether or not to have one high school versus two high schools. And again, we moved here just after that controversy was dying down, and I understood it to be a brand new issue. I had no idea that for years the community had talked about how to keep the kids together. So that was a real surprise to me. The ninth grade center was the final outcome of that controversy. And Bridgepoint opened in 1997 with a huge population. It was our largest school, and it opened with the largest population and was filled to capacity within the first year.
The 9th grade center was a compromise too. And that was kind of a compromise between the two high school and then saying, okay, we'll build a 9th grade center here and kind of separate the freshmen out from that. So it was kind of to appease those that wanted the second high school, because it was very close. It was extremely close.
Yeah.
Vote.
And it was pretty convoluted. I'm going to have to take a couple of months to figure out exactly what all the votes were, because there were some bond votes and some other votes.
And I don't remember the exact timing, but at the time, the Dell Ranch, 2,500 acres, which was a last section, the Wolf Ranch was one section, and the last three sections of the Baldwin Ranch, which goes all the way past to the gallery and all of that stuff, Lake Point. That was all sold. That was all being subdivided. That was going to be thousands and thousands. That was going to be South Austin. And if that had gone through, we absolutely would have had a second high school. And Michael Dell's daughter started riding horses, and he decided he needed a ranch and couldn't drive to Dripping Springs. So he came in and very, very costly reassembled all that land there. And when that happened, now where we're at now is 2,700 kids with quite a few transfers and relatively flat projections. So it's probably really good that we didn't.
It's interesting to see that the decision on opening Westridge was delayed a year because the growth rate flattened out. Well, pretty much the same thing happened with 2001 and the dot-com bust. Our enrollment not only flattened out, it started declining. And that's when the transfer policy was put in place, actually a couple of years later, to try and even that out.
Yeah, when my kids went to Barton Creek L mid-2000s, there were 375 kids in the school, mm-hmm. which we loved. That was much more like Eanes when I went to school there.
Right.
But Barton Creek L was two wings, and one of them was not occupied.
Yeah.
It was literally half
the school. Yeah. Filling the Western schools had a rocky start. But after that decline in 2001, things did pick up again, but never to the growth that was seen in previous decades. It was about 1% growth a year. And we had a number of years where there was just a little bit of steady growth, about 60 to 70 new kids a year, not the 400 plus that was seen on an annual basis on a much smaller base. We are actually seeing a decline again now, probably because the average price of homes in our district has now gone over the 2 million mark. And that makes it a little tricky for families with children to move in. So we're trying to navigate and see what this new real estate environment is going to mean for the district. Just so you know, in terms of enrollment, the high school is now about 2,800. It still hasn't gotten to that 3,000 projection that we had in the early 90s. Each of the middle schools is about 1,000, and each of the elementary schools is in the 550 neighborhood. So pretty good enrollment levels at this point. Well, there is so much more to the Eanes story. You could take any piece of this, the academics, the fine arts, the athletics, that if you remember Scott's wonderful presentation about Pride of the Hill, and we could go deep on so many different things, but we're out of time for today. And I will say that the 21st century history of our district is still being written. And it may take a few years to get some perspective to know what really we should remember over time. But I think what we can remember is in this quote that I found from that wonderful person, Abby Neptune, who was our athletic director for about 30 years. If I ever did write a book, it would be titled Starting Without a Shoelace, because I was here when we didn't have anything. What is unique about Westlake is the people before me who helped pave the way to what is today. We have people here who are dedicated, take chances, expect good things, and believe in themselves. That was true in the beginning. Maybe that's why Robert Eanes said yes. Maybe that's why the Teagues put a pin in it. Maybe that's why Don Rogers gave his best professional 17 years. And maybe that's why all of us are here today. So with that, I'll just leave with a